encourage you to also ways to experience Jesus. And on the back of this, it highlights our Monday Thursday service. And Pastor Tim said we're going to talk about what Monday Thursday is all about. How does it connect to the Exodus, the Passover, and the Passion of Jesus? Join us in the fellowship hall for a Last Supper experience with fellowship, scripture, devotion, and prayer. So that's Thursday, March the 28th at 7 p.m. Immediately after that, our prayer vigil will begin. And then join us again for our Good Friday service here in the sanctuary on Friday at 7. Our Easter morning schedule is 6:30 sunrise at Phillips Shelter at Mizzou Lake. Who's thinking they're going to be there to watch the sunrise? Anybody? All right. I got some fingers. Got some hands. It's cold and it's early, but it is always so good. It is always such a great experience. And then we'll maintain our regular Sunday morning schedule with Easter worship at 9 and at 11. You all may remember Neymar, who was a part of our congregation and lived with the Pointer family at our house for 2 years. Could you flip to the next slide if there's a picture? Oh, there is Neymar with his mom. After Jeremy and he arrived in Jamaica to reunite him with his parents. You may have seen in the... I miss that little firecracker, and Gina said she misses him too. Recently, you may have seen in the prayer request that Neymar's dad died suddenly of a heart attack. And so there are a number of ways that you can be a support to the family, and they need us very much right now. First is to pray for them. Please pray for them. Second is if you'd like to bring a card of sympathy, please do so to the church office by Wednesday. Let them know we're thinking of them. Let Neymar know we miss him. Third is if you'd like to give financially, we've set up a memorial here at the church, and you can write a check to the church and put Nigel Hoylett in the memo, and it will go in the right place. Natalie is not employed right now, and so they could use some assistance. And last, we are going to have a memorial service here for the Maryville community because Neymar's family was a part of a church and a part of schools and soccer clubs, and we're just going to have a time that we can celebrate Nigel's life, and we will live stream or record that so the Hoylets, wherever they are, can be a part of that. Neymar and his brother and mom are in Jamaica, and the two older sisters are here in Missouri. You might have seen a letter that came out from Kim, and there's also copies on the back. So, our friend Neymar. Where is God calling you to engage in the world in the name of Jesus Christ? Let's have open hearts today to be watching and listening for that. Would you please rise as our acolytes come forward, bearing the light of Christ? Thank you.
In Proverbs, the journey goes long. The world is for the moment to be blessed. How do you think of that? Sometimes the road is easy, and that's the warmth of the night he wants us. Some days we rely on the joy of community together. Today, let us come into the light together as we learn to love God and one another through the twists and turns of our life and day. We always welcome us in. We give you our thanks. We give you our thanks. right here where they live. And the truth of it is that you are grateful. So you graciously come to where we are to sit under us and with us. You, O God, bridge the gap that comes to us. And this is that we can believe in God. We can slow down and hold the moment as you hold the star of the universe. And just keep on yourself in your hands. And if it is too late, just all these thoughts. God, we carry many heavy burdens, the layers of sin and darkness and difficulty in our life. But your grace is here. So we're going to take a moment to look into our hearts and see what burdens we carry, and in silence we're standing here. Lord God, you shower blessings upon us, whether we are in the valley or on the mountain top, or honest by person that we carry. There is goodness in your life available to us. So let us take a moment to slow down and to savor some of that goodness that you have sent offering up to you in heaven. And now, as the body of believers, as the body of Christ, we join our hearts, our souls, and our voices in praying the prayer that Jesus taught us and who was here in that moment. Praying, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen.
Thank you.
With us and like us. That's who Jesus is. So, she continues, and now when I leave my heart to you, I will bother God because God is giving me the prophets from being everywhere. I just call straight to Jesus and say, Jesus, please let me from my prophets. Everybody learns something new about Jesus, and that's my prayer for us today as we need to be in a lot of places that represent the Christian faith. That we too can take what we already know of Jesus, what we have already experienced of Jesus, and use it. We pray for it. Holy One, may Jesus be larger and larger in us, so we are able to love as He does. So then we realize that Jesus is God, the God who came to us. And this is the exact same understanding that the author of the Gospel of John has of who Jesus is. If we look at the God, for God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, the begotten in John's Gospel is not about human birth. It's the only gospel that has no birth story, like the other three gospels have in the story of Jesus. How did John begin? That's right. In the beginning was the Word. And the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through Him, all things were made, and without Him, nothing was made that was made. In Him, was that light is the light of the
That was important in the time that John wrote the Gospel because there was an argument in the church that maybe Jesus was a creation of God. That the author of John says, no, Jesus is not a creation of God. Jesus is God. And begins the Gospel with that resounding assertion. So, if it's true that Jesus equals God, that Jesus is God, then in Jesus, God came to us and took all of the sin of humanity with Him Himself. Jesus is Jesus. Jesus is self-giving, is the embodiment of God's self-giving. I wrote holy today in my notes after I read about that and kind of processed that. There's a theologian named John von Strodes from the Middle Ages. And he has this understanding, theological understanding, that the divine motivation for showing up in the world was love. Reckless, relentless, amazing, faithful love. That is the bigger part of the picture, and sin the smaller part of the picture. It was that God saw our suffering, our suffering, and it was God's love that prompted God to move to come to us. Isn't that what we do when we see someone that we love suffering? We move to come to God. We move to bear that suffering with Him. God did the same for us in Jesus. Sin is the cause of our suffering, and God sees that and comes to stand with us and by us.
Father Richard Rohr, who's at the Center for Action and Contemplation in New Mexico, he kind of summarizes this theological idea, saying, Jesus did not come to change God's mind about humanity. God did not change it. Jesus came to change humanity's mind about God. That's what we would think. God has a soul and a spirit and vision for us. That's the soul we have for us. It is we who need to expand our vision, our understanding, and our vision. So gracious. God's love is so inclusive solidarity with humanity. So we can use it for us. And that continues even in the face of the worst food and slavery of the Let's take a step back here and begin looking at the scripture from the top. In verse 14 and 15, it says, "Once Moses lifted up the snake in the wilderness, the Son of Man had to be lifted up, that everyone who believes in him would be lost." Now, this Moses reference is a crazy Hebrew Bible story that Pastor Ken and I explored for quite a while. The children of Israel are wandering in the desert. They're hungry, they're tired, they're lost, and we are never a loss when we are hungry, tired, and lost, never again. Thank you. I'm not for sure. They were lying, and they complained about God, and God brings them to those mistakes. He didn't accept them for them. Check it out in Numbers 21. Okay, James, so that we might know and believe that that darkness, that sin, that self-delusion, that self-centeredness is not the final word. It is the final word. So verse 10, God to love the Lord. He never leaves. Eternal life here is not the hereafter for the Gospel of John, as much as it is the here and now. John translates the phrase kingdom of God that the other Gospel authors use into eternal life, meaning the God life that God is in the kingdom of God. Jesus Christ, the kingdom of God is now. So that you can see and experience. It's just eternal life with a capital M. What a crazy word. I'm going to say it. I'm going to say it. I'm going to say it. Yes. is the deep and wide guidelines for criminal law that God has given us. The survey is not what people are supposed to do, as much as it's talking about the opposite of what we have. It's asking for peace and the opposite of what we have. But if you look at the time of peace, how do we have peace? So verse 16, God did not see that he did the world to surrender the world, but to save the world. And this is what he just said to the world. This is the world where the truth is to be the world. Do you think Jesus is grace right where you are? Or do we teach conditions to be accepted by God? And what did Jesus say? Is either grace right here in the Bible? Or do we teach to be accepted? So it says that if you believe, then you are not human. And if you do not believe, then you are not human. That is a blessing of this. Two are, and we have two different ideas about it. Three good things are here. And I'm wondering if we could see it as, if you believe, then you are receiving that capital L life that we're talking about. If you believe, and we're sort of open, like a funnel from the Spirit of God, the glory. And so we're not here. And if we don't believe, then we're condemned because we are missing out. We are not open. We are not receiving. We are missing out on the glory of God. Jonathan Davis is a Lutheran pastor at St. John Lutheran Church in Minnesota. And he says, maybe Jesus isn't setting a condition of our beliefs, but he's speaking a truth about our beliefs. He says, yes, God loves the world, and God is what he needs to say. But the gospel of God's unconditional love does us no good if we don't believe it. It doesn't do us any good if we don't believe it. So this is why we need to look at the scripture in the context of John 3, because what we just read is in the middle of a conversation between the Pharisee Nicodemus and Jesus. Nicodemus comes to Jesus by night because he's curious. He wants to see, who is this Jesus? I get God, I have this, who is this Jesus? And Nicodemus is on the verge of belief. And Jesus tells him, to enter the kingdom of God, you must be born again, / from above. The Greek word means both again and from above. You must be born again. It's a simple literary technique in the Gospel of John that Jesus says something with a worldly meaning and a spiritual meaning, and the disciples, in this case, with the demons, see the worldly meaning. And John wants us as we do this to say, so, in that first fact, conversion has grace. It's the result of a spirit of birth is purely a gift. We don't have a sin. We just walk it, right? It's God's act. But in verse 16, conversion has faith. Is human decision and human responsibility. Our choice, our response. We must see Jesus first, and then we day in a prison. And us is not either or, but both need. Both are necessary when both are ideas found throughout the New Testament, and there is no attempt to find them in the scriptures. I like what Marcus Ford says, the late Episcopal theologian. He says, salvation comes from God even as it involves our response. God is the source of life, freedom, forgiveness. And that salvation is always involved in our response. Because if the slaves in Egypt have not responded to God's message that God is going to liberate them, then where would they stay in Egypt? And if one by the Methodist did not call God Jesus, Son of God, to have mercy on them, then where would he be? And where would he be? If God responds to the word and nothing that's new from our lives, salvation is the work of God. And yet, we must respond. This is what it says how Jesus has given to our Jesus. This is how much God loved the world. Jesus' Son is one and only Son, and this is God, so that no one need be destroyed. By believing in Him, anyone can have a whole and lasting life. God didn't go to all the trouble of sending His Son merely to point an accusing finger to tell the world how bad it is. He came to help the world be right. Anyone who trusts in Him is acquitted. Anyone who refuses to trust in Him has long since been under the death sentence without even knowing. And why? Because of that one's failure to believe, to see and believe in the one of a kind Son of God. So when I think about what has changed me, what has brought transformation, what has rescued, what has saved me in my life process? It is grace every time. It is grace every time. It is not because I tried harder, or because I worked smarter. I tried as hard as I could. Actually, it was when I accepted myself for who I was right then and there, all the pieces I didn't want, because God right then, all the pieces, including the ones on the cross. Friends, if the gospel is not about grace, then it is about works, and that is never the case. There is a human worthiness competition, and it is alive and well both within the church and within the church, and it gets us nowhere. People of God hear this gospel news this morning. You belong. You are not alone. You are created in the image of God. Every fiber of your being is created. You are precious to God. God desires you to be healed, to be given, and free, and made whole. This is the gospel word. And all of this is true. Jesus, really live honoring this truth about ourselves, about others, and about everyone, then we are following the footsteps of the Savior. So what can we understand these verses more in terms of love? What is love is the difference? Would Jesus become more personal to us? Would Jesus become more real to us, more relevant? With this understanding that Jesus become more real and relevant and personal to those out in the world that we live in. It is clearly correct that we have turned and fallen short of the glory of God in the future of the present. And it doesn't really take much to look around to see that that's true. All of humanity can see that the world is filled with darkness and violence and hate. But what if we saw Jesus standing in solidarity with us? Taking into God's self all that we have already done. What if we saw Jesus as God, and love, and the Word, and the Word? The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness is never in the light. Thank you.